There's no safer statement for Steely Dan than being one of the most revered bands from the 1970s. Across their initial 8 years and 7 albums, they were the antithesis of everything that modern rock was built upon at the time. They took genres that never saw the light of day, pairing them with cryptic, cynical lyricism that they, and maybe a few others, could understand. While it was always Walter Becker and Donald Fagen at the helm, they took a different approach with the definition of what a band could be. They chose to work with a rotating cast of studio musicians, which led to the creation of some of the most important compositions of their era. I'd say for the most part, fans consider their later releases such as The Royal Scam, Asia, or Gaucho to be their finest work, but what if I told you that the record they'd least expect is the one I'd consider to be their best? Hi, I'm Bazz from Bazz Reviews, and this is the best place to discover cool music. The record in question today is their 1972 debut album, Can't Buy a Thrill. While it took almost 6 months to fully write and record, that isn't much time within their musical journey. I take you back to 1967, when the two met each other attending Bard College in Annandale, New York. Walter Becker and Donald Fagen hit it off instantly and began playing in different bands throughout the area. Eventually, the two shifted to writing music instead of playing it, hoping to one day become famous songwriters. And songwriters they became, but not very prominent ones. They somehow found their way working in the famous Brill Building in Brooklyn, going down each floor and knocking on each door to pitch their material to possible buyers for weeks on end. Their boldness sort of worked out for them. Barbara Streisand ended up recording one of their compositions in 1971, and Kenny Vance of Jay and the Americans hired them as touring members in their backing band. In the meantime, Becker and Fagen were still unsatisfied with where their careers were. That is, until they met one Gary Katz, staff producer for ABC Records in Los Angeles. He was impressed with their prior work and hired the duo as staff songwriters for the label. On top of that, he suggested that they form a band to record many of the songs they had been sitting on for years. Considering Becker and Fagen had failed in past attempts to start their own band, they gladly accepted the offer. So, with the help of old friends Denny Diaz and Jeff Skunk Baxter, plus drummer Jim Hodder and vocalist David Palmer, Becker and Fagen officially formed the first iteration of Steely Dan in 1972. Now that we've gotten their abridged history out of the way, I want to take you deeper into the 10 tracks on this record and explore why they are as memorable as they are. I'm not alone in this endeavor, though. I've got a fellow Steely Dan fan joining me.
Hi, I'm Nick Rogers. I make YouTube videos, and I have been a pretty big fan of Steely Dan for a while now, mainly just due to their amazing studio wizardry. But yeah, I'm excited to get into this debut record.
Can't Buy a Thrill opens up with the smoky Latin jazz track that is Do It Again. Even if you're not a Steely Dan fan, you've surely heard this song at one point or another. It's the song that put them on the map, and if you think about it, this song was the perfect introduction to what these guys were planning to do. No lyricist at the time would have dared to talk about killing some dude that's stealing water, getting away with it, hooking up with a woman out of jealousy just to leave her and beg for her forgiveness, then going to gamble his money away in Vegas, all in the same song. Plus, I think it's a display of just how incomparable Donald Fagen is as a frontman. It's funny because he actually didn't want to sing in the first place. He didn't think his voice was worthy of singing in a rock and roll band, yet the members still encouraged him to stick with it, and the rest is history. The instrumentation is equally as fresh, ranging from an electric sitar to a shitty Yamaha YC30 organ to keep the listeners coming back for more. The song charted as high as number 6 on the Billboard Hot 100 in 1973, and our next song saw similar success on the charts.
Picture this, if you will. You're living in the 70s right when this album came out, and you just had your mind blown from the previous eargasm that was Do It Again. You're thinking to yourself, how could it get any better than this? And then Dirty Work comes on. This is one of the only Steely Dan cuts to feature David Palmer on lead vocals, who was initially brought on to sing for Fagen live. Ultimately, his inclusion in the band was short-lived, as he was let go from the band following the tour for the album. However, during his short time, he elevated one of the band's biggest commercial hits to new heights with his stunning vocal performances. The song follows a man who is being used by a married woman in the midst of an affair, and it details his regret and self-loathing with the decision to not end it. Even with this taboo subject matter, this song is an elegant display of jazz instrumentation and tropical-leaning tendencies that they would lean into on later releases. The production is crisp, but the performance of the track is impeccable, and the vocals, as I mentioned before, are so beautifully soulful that it puts the song on a whole nother level, a perfect follow-up to the opening.
Kings is the next track on deck, and it might be one of my favorites on the entire album. I can certainly understand why it would blip over a listener's radar. After all, it did have to follow up two of the group's biggest hits. Don't be fooled, because it has some incredible harmonies that stretch from the verses into the infectious refrain. The strong piano groove here resembles Becker and Fagan's love for Chicago blues of old. All of that collides with an over-the-top instrumental break later in the song, sliding Elliot Randall electric guitar lines and all. We see the guys go deeper with their lyricism too, as it takes on more of a double meaning in Kings. Tales of middle-aged royalty are an allusion to recent American presidents Richard Nixon and John F. Kennedy. If you do your homework after watching this video, you'll realize this is one of the sharpest pieces of writing Becker and Fagan gave us on the album. At the time they wrote it, though, little did they know it wouldn't actually be the last they'd see of good King Richard.
Following up Kings is Midnight Cruiser, following the perspective of a midnight man wandering and reflecting upon the lost opportunities of life. For the song's sour subject matter, it is quite cheery and upbeat sonically. With bright keys, striking percussion, and blues guitar guiding the track, the song creates a vibrantly rich atmosphere. This is only complemented by the chorus of the song, which is honestly one of the catchiest on the whole album. Plus, the vocal harmonies and subsequent guitar solo after the second chorus sends me to the fifth dimension every time. And while you might think it's Donald Fagen singing the lead vocals on the track here, it is actually drummer Jim Hodder filling on the mic. Overall, this song is more than a highlight on this highlight-filled record.
To close out the A-side, we've got one more Latin-inspired song in Only a Fool Would Say That. I think the more that I listen to Can't Buy a Thrill, the case for this song being the best on the album keeps growing. There's not much difference between the way that this and Do It Again sound on the surface, but I prefer this arrangement a bit more than the former. While I do like Do It Again, I can't say it doesn't overstay its welcome. There's so much more character in the mix on Only a Fool Would Say That. Donald Fagen brings his A-game with his vocal delivery, and it's used as another sarcastic clash against those involved in the 1970s political movements. The lyrics are equally sarcastic, quite possibly the most braggadocious on the album in my opinion. Back to my earlier note on the arrangement again, I think one of my favorite parts on the song has to be that gorgeous key change at the bridge. Like the song itself, it's short, subtle, and I wish it didn't have to resolve after 15 seconds. Let's head on over to the B-side, where we'll start things off with
Reeling in the Years. This is the most streamed song on the album and of their entire catalog. Everyone and their grandmother has heard this infectiously fun jazz rock banger. Even with its possible oversaturation, I feel like it's hard to hate on this song. For starters, the guitar work on this song is immaculate. All you have to do is turn to Elliot Randall's famous solo. According to him, it only needed 2 takes to complete the entire thing. Even Jimmy Page of Led Zeppelin threw him some props, calling that solo his favorite of all time. That's pretty fucking impressive if you ask me. This is coming from a guitarist as well. Along with that, the band's chemistry is unbelievable across the 4.5 minutes. The performances of this song are watertight, from Fagan's stunning vocals, Hodder's drums, supporting guitar play from Skunk and Diaz, and the incredibly sweet chord progressions. It deserves all the acclaim it gets for a myriad of reasons.
As I talked about in the introduction, Becker and Fagan never settled for second best in their recordings. In light of this, everything that you hear in their songs is nearing the limits of human possibility. Nick also talked about Elliot Randall's masterful solo just a couple of minutes ago, and we see perfection demonstrated once again on Fire in the Hole. Donald Fagan killed his piano solos, and I'm somewhat flustered in describing my true feelings on this. The movement and expression here are smooth as butter. I don't know how they got the sound of it to be so clean, but we can likely attribute that to Gary Katz, who became the group's producer after they joined ABC. The lyrical content, on the other hand, is not as strong as it could have been. It's relatively ambiguous to me. I can't really figure out if it's supposed to be another angsty political track, or if I'm just missing something deeper within it. Be that as it may, but Fire in the Hole stands out as having one of the most memorable musical moments on the album. Even if I don't listen to the entire track, it's this piano solo that I always want to revisit.
Brooklyn is the second song led by David Palmer, and it's another unique composition that features a more down-tempo and mellow vibe along with it. That can be a make-or-break thing for some people, but I think the instrumental is a highlight for me. I can't think of a more serene-sounding song on this album than this one. It's not to take anything away from the stellar performance by him and the backup singers that come in at the chorus, though its inclusion of different instruments, most notably the steel pedal guitar, creates such a unique atmosphere that differentiates the track from the others on the B-side. While Brooklyn may not be as remarkable in its presentation, it is absolutely essential to the flow of this album. Most of all, I feel like it's a bit underappreciated in the grander scheme of Steely Dan's discography.
Change of the Guard is the 9th and penultimate song on Can't Buy a Thrill, and just another standout on the already fabulous B-side. In an alternate world where Becker and Fagan had just stayed as songwriters and let any other band record it, there's not a doubt in my mind it would have been a hit. It's not because it's much simpler in composition compared to their B-side contemporaries, but it's because it sounds so much happier than the rest of their catalog. The story they tell here shouldn't go unnoticed either, because it has an interesting message. I've always felt that this song and Kings go very well together thematically. The change of the guard the song is referring to is likely the counterculture generation that the duo were involved in the 1960s. Now that Becker and Fagen are older and more mature, they have to adapt to the changing expectations of society in the early 1970s. Boomers might brush off this song as two pretentious hippies reminiscing about their glory days, but I stand by it being a surprisingly introspective song that holds up pretty well today. And now we've reached the end of the album with Turn That Heartbeat Over Again, a song that Dan heads either love or hate. I think it's a well-written song overall, but a complete mess musically. I'm honestly surprised that it passed Becker and Fagen's threshold of acceptance. To be fair, it was actually recorded after Can't Buy a Thrill was finished, but don't sit there and tell me it doesn't even sound slightly rushed. The verses are all in one key at one tempo, and then they go to another tempo and key for the chorus. That's a compositional choice I haven't seen in many songs before. And the instrumental bridge is sort of there, but that too is a bit lacking compared to the ones on the rest of the album. What all of this tells me is Turn That Heartbeat Over Again was probably two different versions that they couldn't decide on using, so they spliced them together and called it a day. On a positive note, it sounds like something they could have made for Pretzel Logic or Katie Lied, so that shows off a bit of maturity and poise on their part. Had they workshopped it a little bit more and released it down the road, it could have been a less divisive song among their fans. However, I don't want a less than ideal ending to overshadow the reality at hand. It's unfortunate that I can't hear people talking about how great Can't Buy a Thrill is. Yes, I definitely understand why a lot of Dan heads might gravitate towards Pretzel Logic, The Royal Scam, or Asia. They might argue this album might not have the best songs, or it wasn't as polished or ambitious as later titles. I won't lie, it is a bit messy and had multiple radio hits that got overplayed, but neither of those things are bad by any means. Without this album, I don't think we would have seen some of the crazy shit they did down the road. Despite being their debut, Becker, Fagen, and their compatriots did a lot right. When you look at Steely Dan and the discography as deep as they have, Can't Buy a Thrill set such a high bar for everything that came after it. It has a lot to call its own that makes it stand out just as much. I loved the use of multiple vocalists, a politically charged lyrical style, and their willingness to experiment with multiple genres and sounds. I think all of these things conclusively lead me to say that it is my favorite album from Steely Dan, and one of my favorites of all time. Each of the 41 minutes on here is unforgettable, filled to the brim with lyrical and sonic uniquities that went against the grain in an otherwise stacked year of music in 1972. During a 1977 interview with the group, Walter Becker admitted that he actually had zero expectations with Can't Buy a Thrill. He continued saying, "In fact, we were amazed that ABC even bought the album at all. It was like a dream come true." And a dream come true it was, for music fans back in the day, and fans of music today when they hear what this album has to offer. To think that two once English majors at a small liberal arts college on the Hudson River had to go door to door and beg people to record their music, and then establish themselves as one of the biggest bands of the 1970s is nothing short of amazing. Except I still can't get over the fact that they named themselves after a motorized dildo.